comes from John chapter 6, verses 1 through 21. We've been reading from Mark, and we know Jesus has been bouncing from location to location, teaching and performing miracles. So as we hear this John reading, you can pretend we're still in Mark, bouncing from location to location. After this, Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for them each to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near to the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. This ends our reading of the word. Please join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Some of you had the privilege of meeting Reverend John Peterson at my ordination. He was the person on crutches who gave the invocation. John is a gifted writer and powerful preacher. He's theoretically retired, but still serving churches fairly regularly. He's preaching today, and being a person who never leaves anything until the last minute, he sent me his preliminary draft a couple of weeks ago. The congregation he's serving today is in for a real treat, a really wonderful message. I was tempted to use his sermon for our worship today. Instead of borrowing his words, though, I'm going to borrow his theme and then expand on it a bit. John is a skeptic. He was a chaplain in Vietnam and a mass unit. His views have been colored by the horrors he witnessed. He saw far too many times when miracles did not happen. Far too many times when it felt like prayers were a waste of breath. Somehow, though, he has managed to maintain a faith in the God who loves us unconditionally and who asks only our love in return. His skeptical mind has a tough time with scriptures like our reading today. What do you do with a miracle text when you aren't sure you believe that miracles happen? It needs he's not that miracle. Well, John found a way to bring that miracle into our everyday lives, into the here and now, by asking the question, what is enough? How many loaves and how much fish does it take to have enough? He gave a couple of really emotional examples of the miracle of enough, moving people from a perception of scarcity or from an actual position of scarcity to a position of wholeness. That's where I'd like to start. When in our lives have we had enough so that we actually had leftovers to spare? When has God's presence been enough for us to see it and experience its bounty? When has life been enough? When do we have enough that we're able to extravagantly give the excess away? Dreams can be wonderful. We dream of many things. We dream of graduating from high school. Maybe we dream of marriage. If we're blessed with children, we dream of their futures. If we have a daughter, we dream of her wedding day. A couple of years ago, I had the joy of stepping into the middle of a mother's dream for her daughter's wedding. She had 6 children of her own, plus had adopted 2 sons, and only one of those kids was a daughter. Mom and daughter had a close, loving relationship. So close and loving that daughter was free to live her own life by her own rules. She was even free not to practice the religion mom had so carefully shared with her children. After several years content in a loving relationship with no desire to marry, daughter finally decides, kind of spur of the moment, that she does, after all, want to marry the love of her life. Mom is ecstatic until daughter says quite firmly, "No wedding. We are just getting married. A simple civil ceremony, nothing religious. 2 witnesses, no wedding." Well, mom has dreams and the financial ability to make those dreams a reality. Daughter has plans that threaten to crush all those dreams. How does a mother let go of the dream of seeing her only daughter as a bride? Mom was thrilled her daughter was marrying, but so deeply disappointed by the how. But daughter and mom had that special, loving relationship that respected each other's individuality. So out of the respect for the freedom she had enjoyed as daughter, out of love for mom, she offered a compromise. There could be a wedding if there were no guests, and it was at the family home. No guests. Mom is from a large, close-knit Catholic family. There are aunts and uncles and siblings and nieces and nephews and cousins. Mom has all kinds of friends. Dad has family, friends, and business associates. And what about daughter's friends? What about the brothers and their families? Another compromise. Only the immediately nuclear family could attend. No friends. Parents of the bride and groom, siblings of the bride and groom, spouses of the siblings, and children of the siblings. That's it. No aunts, uncles, cousins, nobody extra. Absolutely no. So here was the miracle. From no wedding to a compromise of a teeny tiny wedding. From dreams of filling a beautiful Catholic church with family and friends, a priest, communion, an organist, to some folding chairs under the tree in the backyard, a Protestant pastor, a simple ceremony stripped of almost all religion except a very tiny prayer, and a boombox. But these These few loaves and couple of fish were what was available. Daughter reluctantly agreed to a wedding dress, but grumbled about having to wear it. Mom used restraint, but also used her artistic abilities to decorate in a minimalist fashion with elegance. The ceremony was short, simple, and to the point. The tiny music, bitter music, was anything but traditional, but it was perfect for the bride's sense of humor and true to her personality. At the dinner, elegantly served on real china with linen tablecloths and napkins on the table that was set up under a festive white canopy with little twinkling lights in the yard, the daughter turned to the mom and asked, "Was it all that you hoped for?" As an outsider looking in, I thought I detected a bit of mockery in her tone, and I thought, just for a moment, I saw recognition of that mockery in Mom's face. But then the loaves and fishes became enough, and Mom replied with joy overflowing, "Yes, yes, it was all that I dreamed of and more." And the miracle of family, the miracle of bond between mother and daughter, between two very different women, allowed so much love to pass between them that there was enough and more to spare. There was love to bridge the gaps and more. When my brother died, I needed a miracle. You know all the stuff you have to do when there's a death, how challenging it is to get all the arrangements made, rearrange your life for a few days, be present for family as you work through grief together, and still find time for taking care of yourself. Well, Steve died late on a Wednesday, just before Memorial Weekend. We didn't have time to do his service before the weekend, so it got delayed until Tuesday. That was a long time to be on hold, waiting and waiting for that final goodbye. It's a long time to have life disrupted, especially when mine had already been disrupted by being away for almost 2 weeks at the seminary in Holland. I was feeling lost, and I told a friend what I really needed was some normal. His response took my nearly exhausted energy and turned it into enough and more. He said, "Let me tell you about my everyday miracles." And then he proceeded to give me a play-by-play of his very routine day, starting with describing his first cup of coffee that morning, and the work he had accomplished, and the things that had put a smile on his face. And by the time he finished, I was re-energized. My spirit had been restored, and his simple words had become the gift of loaves and fishes that allowed me to have enough energy for myself and more to spare for my family. Last month, I was excited about my ordination, but also a bit concerned. What if there weren't very many people here? What if almost nobody showed up? I had hoped there'd be at least 30. I thought 50 would be wonderful. I don't know if anyone did a head count, but I know we had to set up folding chairs, and I had to print more bulletins twice, and we still ran out. I estimate there were about 150 people here. Even though we could have found seating for a few more in some of the pews, the church felt full. What it was full of was love. There was love all the way to the ceiling, love in every nook and cranny, and love pouring out the doors. The love that was shared, some from each person to each person, was such a bounty that if we could have gathered up the leftovers, the love that wasn't soaked up, we wouldn't have been able to come up with enough containers for all of it. It was multiplying quicker than it would have been possible to contain it. It was all that I had been dreaming of, all that I had hoped for, and more, so very much more. I don't know exactly how Jesus managed to distribute five little loaves and two fish that were small enough to be an appropriate lunch for a boy to feed 5,000 people and have 12 baskets of leftovers. But when I consider the many times that we have been blessed with enough and more, when I consider the countless times that God pours out extravagant love, offering all that we need and more, I am sure there will always be miracles to feed our souls. There will always be enough and more. The question then for us is, how will we participate in perpetuating the miracle of enough? Will we have eyes to see God's bounty when it's given to us? And will we have hands and hearts to offer the miracle of enough to others? May we always have eyes to see, ears to hear, and hands to give away the miracle of God's love. Amen. Participate in that giving away of love now by giving our offering.